Michelle, and I'm going to be the instructor for CCNA Security and CCNP as well. Okay. Currently, we're not offering CCID because most of our students is actually pursuing the path of MA and MB. For the IE, it takes time for them to go for it because for CCNP, they need to pass 3 exams before they can get the cert. So we wanted the student to go through the process of certification before they can go for the highest path, which I will be explaining later on. Okay. Now I have a master's in engineering. Okay, as for my educational background, I also have a bachelor's degree in computer engineering. I love studying, so if I want to go up to the doctorate level, but I realized that certification can earn more, can give me more income, you know. So I tried to start from the master's and proceed with the certification. After the master's, I immediately proceed with certification. I was certified with CCNA way back 2006. That's a long time ago, right? So how did I maintain my certification? Because Cisco have an expiration date for every cert that you will take. So for CCNA, it will be valid for 3 years. For CCNP as well, it will be 3 years. And for the CCIE, it's 2 years. Okay, every cert that Cisco offers has a validity. Okay, so every 3 years is the standard. So you have to renew every 3 years, you have to renew every 2 years, whichever certification you have. So for example, CCNA certified and you want to go for CCNP, for example, your CCNA certification is expiring soon. So you can either retake the CCNA or you can go for the higher certification level, which is CCNP. So if you pass the 3 CCNP exam, it will actually, one of it, if you pass the CCNP exam, it will auto-renew your CCNA. So you have an option. You want to go for a higher cert, or you just want to renew your existing cert. So that's how Cisco works. I also have certification for Microsoft, because in troubleshooting, you also need to find out what is happening with the other, you know, what is the other story. Like for example, it's a network issue, but it could be a system issue or a desktop issue, right? So it's not all the time a network problem. Like for example, a user cannot remote desktop to a server. Do you use remote desktop? Yes? Okay. So most of the time the users, sometimes they often have access to a server, like remote desktop access or intranet access. So if they complain that I cannot remote desktop to a server, there could be a lot of issues, okay? One is network issue, another could be a system issue, and another could be a desktop issue, right? Or maybe a user issue, okay, user problem. So most of the time, if the users cannot access via remote desktop to a server, they will blame it to who? Networking, right? They'll always blame everything. Internet slow, cannot access to the remote desktop, intranet cannot be accessed, everything is networking. So in order to defend yourself, right, you need to know the other side of the story. Like for example, you need to know systems, you need to know desktop. So there could be chances, the reason why they cannot remote desktop on their servers is because the server guy who's managing the server might have done some updates for the server, right? Like security updates. So during the updates, right, the security features of the server, you know, went to a higher level in such a way that remote desktop is not allowed. By default, remote desktop is actually not allowed on all servers. You have to activate it. So if there's an update on the server, then the security features of the server will go higher, then nobody can remote desktop. So it could be a systems problem, right? It's not a network issue. Or the user don't know how to remote desktop. Okay, it could be a user problem. Or the user have a NIC or network interface card problem. You know, actually he cannot only remote desktop, he also cannot access to anywhere. No internet, cannot access to any servers, and he's within the network. So it could be a desktop issue. So there's a lot of factors. So at least you need to know systems a little bit, and you need to know network. So if you're focusing on network alone, you want to specialize in network, of course, you need to have the basic of server, which is the MCSA, and you need to have the CCNA, and you have to proceed to the higher certification of networking, like CCNP. But if your interest level is on the server side, you'll just need a CCNA. You'll just need a CCNA for network side, and then MCSA and MCSE for the server. Okay? Most of the companies are managing their servers, they're using Microsoft instead of Linux most of the time. So you need to be certified in Microsoft server. Okay, so I have introduced myself. Oh, by the way, I have 10 years of experience as a network engineer. I don't look like, you know, having 10 years of experience, but actually I have 10 years of experience in networking field. I'm not only teaching, I actually been to several companies. The highest position that I've gotten is the regional network engineer for the entire Asia Pacific. So this means I'm level 3, okay? If a level 1, level 2 cannot resolve it, they'll proceed or call me level 3 support to solve the issue. So if I want to sleep early, I'll quickly solve for them. Unless I let them do, I want to watch a movie first, and then they'll try to do, and then after I finish watching movie, then I'll just fix for them. Okay? Now that is really hectic work, you know, you have to be 24/7 on call. Yeah, that's the life of a network engineer. Once you become really expert, they'll need you more. But of course, the salary will be really high. Okay? So after I introduce myself, I want you to introduce yourselves as well. You just let me know your name, how should I call you, and if there's any certification that you have, you just have to mention your current company and your current position, and which course you're interested in.
My name is Thomas. I'm currently working as an IT support in one of the government's company, Tesla. Then I have currently finishing MCSA, but I failed the exam, so the exam has been taken. Probably it's not studying hard enough for the question.
Okay. Oh, by the way, MCSA is easier than CCNA. Or the exam was easier than CCNA is really difficult. But in my class, most of the students normally pass. Okay. Normally, I tell them what to do on the exam and give them an overview of what to expect. And they need to be expert in lab. In Microsoft, it's multiple choice. In Cisco, there's a lab. So you have to be prepared. Okay?
My name is James.
James, okay.
I completed MCSE and MCP.
Oh, okay. So MCSE and MCP. Okay.
So now I'm taking up the CCNA.
You're taking currently a CCNA or you want to take CCNA?
Want to take.
Oh, want to take, okay. Okay, so let's start. I'll have some demos here later on, but I'll give you the overview or the path, which path you need to go. You know, you need to specialize. In networking, it's not like you want to go for CCNA immediately, CCNP. Actually, you can have specialization. You can choose whichever specialization you want to focus on, okay? Well, the basic is really CCNA. Everyone who wants to be expert in networking need to take up and need to pass CCNA. Now, if you have heard in others that you have to take two exams, or for example, there's like ICNB1, ICNB2, that one's really long, okay? If I were you, I'll just take the CCNA immediately, because it will be the same certification as taking the ICNB1, ICNB2. Okay? If you take two exams, it will be more expensive. It will be more stressful for you because two exams means a lot of coverage, you know. First exam, there will be a lab, there will be multiple choice. Second exam, there will be a lab, there will be multiple choice. It's more topics included. If you just take one shot CCNA exam, it will be shrink into lesser topics that is included, okay, on the exam. And they won't focus on a lot of things, okay? And the exam duration will be, not so long, but it's easier for you to pass. okay? And next will be CCNP. Okay, if you want to go for routing and switching path, you have to take CCNP. Okay, but if you want to go for security path, you have to go for CCNA security first before you can go to CCNP security. Okay, now this level is the basic, okay? The basic or the associate level, CCNA associate level. So once you go for professional level, right? Professional level, you can choose between CCNP, CCNA security, CCNP security for security specialization. If you want to specialize on voice, it's going to be CCVP. For design, I've forgotten to place. You need to take CCDA, which is Cisco Certified Design Associate, before you can go to CCDP, and then you can proceed to CCIE. Now, amongst this specialization, which one is the best? Actually, the best is CCNP. The reason why is CCNP has three modules, okay? Three modules inside. It is containing of switch, route, and troubleshooting. Now, these three modules covers almost all of this. Almost a bits and pieces of some topics here, okay? Some topics here. And for job-wise, right, if you are looking for a job, if you have a CCNP certification, you'll have more chances because the job opening is more towards CCNP routing and switching. And they don't hire someone who's like CCNP security because most of the time you'll be troubleshooting. If you're troubleshooting firewall, and don't you know that a firewall, like even an IT support can maintain a firewall, okay? Anyone can maintain a firewall. The reason why is really easy. Because firewall nowadays is a GUI. GUI means just drag and drop. You know, it's easy. You just select who's the source, what is the network of the source, what is the network of destination, which port you want to block. That's it. Okay, it's GUI. So everyone can maintain. You can study or learn up firewall when you are working as a network engineer. So once you become a network engineer, you're going to be managing the firewall. So you don't need this certification. You just go for the CCNP. It also includes a little bit of voice and a QoS and a design. Okay, design is really important. So CCNP has a route module, switch module, which includes the design of your campus network. So it's really good. Okay, so I advise you to take CCNP. Then, of course, all this specialization leads you to the CCIE level, which is a really expensive certification exam. It will cost you around $5,000 to take the exam alone. Exam and no training. I know that the training can cost you up to $10,000. $5,000 to $10,000, okay, for this one. That's the reason why not all people will go for CCIE. They will try to have the experience first before they go for IE. Okay? So this is the certification path. Okay. Oh, by the way, amongst this Cisco certification, we are offering NA, NP, CCNP, CCNA security. That's it. Okay, these are the following that we offer. Okay, for the certification in Cisco. So all of these are teaching. For the Microsoft, it's MCSA and MCSE. All is 2012. Okay? If you're taking now, right, it's 2012, correct?
Mm.
Okay,
yeah.
So they're coming up with 2016, but nobody's using 2016 yet. I think the company will migrate after 3 years or 4 years only. Okay, so currently 2012 is still okay. And we have the security course, which is, we call it a network security and penetration testing. It's the same as, you know, like hacking courses, CEH, the Certified Ethical Hacker. Okay, that CEH is equivalent to this one. Okay, it's the same company, it's the same certification company who developed the CEH, it's NSPT. They come up with a new security certification. Okay, it's more towards Linux base. Okay, and we have the Excel Basic and Excel Advanced and Linux Fundamentals. So for you all, you are interested with networking, so I advise you to have this certification. Okay, now we'll start with data center equipment. So you'll learn something new here, you know, some simple troubleshooting and what are the models that we normally use in our company. And I bet you've seen most of them, most of the equipments, because you have access to your data center, your server room, your network room or switch room, okay? There's a lot of them that they use. But when you take the CCNA, I'll let you know what's the correct term for that, okay? Now, you are using switches, right? Okay, in some companies, they have budget constraint, they might be using a lower end switch. Actually, switches, if you have heard about layer 2 and layer 3 switches, right? Have you heard about it? Okay, if you're in the IT field, you did study about OSI layers. If you're in the IT, definitely you have studied that. It's included in the CCNA curriculum as well, and in your exam. OSI and TCP/IP. Now we have layer 2, layer 3. Layer 2 means the function is only switching functions, like it can create VLAN, it has an IP, you can remote into it, you can assign port to the respective VLAN. There's a lot of features. All the switch features is all in layer 2. Now we have layer 3 switches, means it can perform switching functions, and it also can perform routing. Switching and routing. So that's really good, but it's really expensive. Okay? The price is more expensive than a router, a normal router price. So layer 3 switches, how can you differentiate layer 2 from layer 3? Layer 2 always starts with 2. The model is 2. Okay? Actually you can see the model from here on the right side of the switch, right hand corner of your switch. So it starts with 2, example 2950, 2960, those were layer 2. Okay, you can recall the function of layer 2 and layer 3 once you study the CCNA. Okay? It's in the OSI layer. So layer 2 is data link, layer 3 is network layer. Okay? So if you happen to see it starts with with 3, the model starts with 3. Those were layer 3 switches. What are the models? 3550, 3750, 3560. All that starts from 3 up, like 3, 4, and 6, all is capable of layer 3, which means it can perform routing, it can perform switching as well. Okay? Now, what is a switch to? We normally use switch to, you know, to provide more connections. Last time, the first ever was a hub, right? Okay, when you had your first internet connection, what is your first internet connection? It's a dial-up connection, right? How many users can connect? Dial-up connection, your modem, you have a modem, right? So how many users can connect, or how many PCs is connected to the modem?
Only
one, right? So what if you have 2? Yeah, you use hub. Actually, hub is a layer 1 device. It's like a splitter only. Okay, it doesn't do anything, so it's splitter. Okay, now they exchange it to a switch, because switch can give you more ports at the same time. The switch is giving you the bandwidth is the same. So it's 100 MB for each of the user. So if you have more users, you have to purchase a switch. So if in your company you have 20 users, like for example, 100 users in your company, how many switches will you buy? So normally for a company, like for example, you have a project, your boss will always ask you to purchase, you're going to be doing the procurement of your switches, right? Okay, so once you become a network engineer, you'll be in charge of the procurement of the switches. So you will ask quotations from different companies, and then you have to compare which one is cheaper and which one gives more support. Okay? Normally, switches comes along with 8, 12, 24, and 48 port. And typical switch will look like this. Okay? It looks like this. It's a one rack unit. It is like 1 to 1.5 inch, like this. Things don't change. Okay? This is a 1U switch. So it doesn't matter whether it's 24 port, 48 port, it's still one rack unit in space. Okay? Now if you have, let me give you an example. If your boss asks you to purchase a switch, okay, How many switches will you buy if the project includes 100 users or 100 PC? So what are the ports and how many switches will you buy? Will you buy 5x24 port? Will you buy how many switches? Now there's three things that you'll need to consider when you purchase a switch. First thing is actually are the switches that you purchase, can they support your company for 3 years? Normally it's 3 years roadmap. So is it okay for expansion? Can it support expansion in your company? The second is you have to consider whether is there, first one is actually the budget, okay? Your budget. Number one is the budget that you need to consider. The second one is expansion. Can it support up to 3 years roadmap? That's a standard, 3 years. Once you purchase an equipment, it must last you for 3 years. And the third one is a rack space. Rack space. Normally, for server room, server rack, you don't have enough space, right? You purchase so many switches, where will you place the rest? The floor? Of course not. You'll fail the audit if you place it on the floor. So, based on those three considerations, budget, expansion, and rack space, how many switches will you buy if you have 100 users? 3 times how many?
2 times 48.
2 times 48, and this is 96. Yeah,
plus
1 times 8. How many ports again? 3 equipment. Okay, another thing is budget-wise. things. Okay, so 3 times 48. Now, this is the number one rule. Whenever your boss asks you to purchase a new switch, purchase a 48 board. Cheaper, cost effective, and no worries for you. When it comes to expansion, you don't have to purchase a new one. You don't have to configure a new one. So you only have one switch. Now, you might be thinking, oh, will it fail? No. 100% the switch won't crash unless the switch is 5 years old or it's a second hand. Get it? Switch don't crash, right? Okay? Questions? Okay. Now, how does it look like? If you see a lot of holes or a lot of ports, that is a switch. Okay? When you happen to step in your data center or network room or server room or switch room, you can see like green lights, you know, flashing green lights, those were switches. And normally for flashing green lights, it should be 48 port or 24 port. Okay, very common 48 port. So that's a switch. Okay, routers. Well, there's a lot of routers example here. Now in CCNA, we're only using the simple router, you know, like 1841, you can use 1900. Okay, how about the models of the router? For router, well, earlier the models of the switch I already discussed with you, right? If the company don't have enough budget, they'll just stick to layer 2 switch. It can do a lot of things. It can do VLAN, can do a lot of things, okay? But if the company has budget, they will try to, especially government agencies, they'll try to purchase the most expensive one. It's something like this. Will you purchase an Atom PC or an i7 PC? Oh, by the way, what do you normally do when you have a laptop? You just surf internet, right? Yeah, do you do gaming? Of course not all the time, right? Because you just surf internet. Every day you just surf internet. See email. Can an Atom laptop do that? Atom PC? Just surf internet and email. Atom PC can do that, right? Can i7 do? Yes. So both can do. So will you purchase an Atom? Should be able to purchase, but of course you want the latest, which is i7. You want faster processor, you purchase the i7. Correct? Same thing with your switch. Would you like to purchase more features or lesser features? If you have budget, then why not purchase the higher capacity? Okay, so they normally purchase a layer 3 switch for government companies because they have budget. Okay, for routers, okay? Routers, it also have some equivalent, which is equivalent to Atom or i7. Normally, it is because of the bandwidth, okay? They have those 1800 series, 1900 series, and then we have those 2800 series, 2900 series. This one is equivalent to like Atom PC, as I told you. This is i7 as well. Okay? Now if your bandwidth, this has a capability to support up to 10 MB. Now if in case your company wants to upgrade to 15, actually this one still can support, but of course it's gonna be slower. You know, it's like installing a higher OS in your Atom PC. A higher OS, right? So you want to install, what's the latest OS that you have now? Windows 10, right? You want to install Windows 10 on Atom PC. Of course, it's really slow, correct? But if you install Windows 7, will still be okay? Yeah, it will still work perfectly fine. But when you install Windows 10, it could be slower. You get it? So, 10 MB, this one I know is 20 MB. Okay, but if you are these routers, why they're still releasing these routers is because most companies they will have a private connection. If you have heard about it, they call it Metro E, MPLS or Leastline. If you have heard about it, it's a private connection from one side to another side. You don't have to access via the internet, so there's not a lot of traffic. Okay, so they'll just subscribe to E19 means 2 MB. So from one side to another side, it's only 2 MB. You might be thinking, wow, that's really slow. Actually, it's not, because you're not competing with the internet traffic. It's a dedicated traffic from side to side. This is not VPN. It's actually a side-to-side connection. It's like a leased line. It's a private link. Okay? Now, really low bandwidth, so you can just purchase this one. And the price for this one is like less than 2,000 sing. Less than 2,000 sing. Okay? So it's easy for you to purchase this one. Now, if you want to use a high-end router, this router is meant for internet. Then you use this one, or maybe you want very high-end, you know, those 2 rack unit routers, they have 3800 and 3900. So this one have more ports behind. You can slot in a lot of things, extra ports, see. Actually, this one is 1800, you know, very less ports. Router, you only have 2 ports most of the time. One for your switch, connecting to the switch, which is the LAN, and the other one is connecting to your modem, which is the WAN. That's it. Just need 2. Okay? Now, what about this one? Well, this one, I have this because I'm using this for the lab purpose. In the industry, you don't use this. Okay? So if you go enroll for CCNA, I'll explain to you what I use this for. For higher-end routers like 3800 series, they can actually support VoIP cards, okay? It can be a voice gateway, voice router, so you can slot in more, okay? For CCNA, you just need this one, very simple, because you're just going to be performing simple routing protocols and static routes. Okay, now how about firewalls? Well, in CCNA, there's no firewalls, but actually, there will be a fundamental of firewall configuration. What are those access controllers? Okay, this is what we do from day to day, you know, day to day job of a network engineer. If he's a level 2 or she or she is a level 2 or level 3 engineer, he's actually making changes on the firewall, so allowing or denying users. Okay, so firewall rules, actually before they come up with the firewalls, they have routers. Okay. Whatever the firewall can do, the router can do right away. Can a company have no firewalls? Yes, it's fine. Without a firewall, the company still can work. You can use your router to perform the firewall commands, which is the access control list. Now, you're going to be studying that in your CCNA class. I think it's on the last day, CCNA class. So the basic of access control list is actually done in your router. So if you're expert on it, the CLI version on router, definitely it's going to be really easy for you for the GUI version, which is on your firewall. Okay? Your router can perform a lot of things. It can do DHCP, which is included in CCNA. DHCP can do NAT. It can do firewall rules. And it can be a gateway for everyone, can do inter-VLAN, there's a lot of things the firewall can do. The reason why we have separate devices for each of the functions, like for example, if you have DHCP, you tend to have a DHCP server, it's because we don't want everything in your router. It's one point of failure, no redundancy, right? If your router crashes, everything crashes. No IP for everyone, because a DHCP server is your router, correct? So they try to separate it. Inter-VLAN is not done in a router, it could be on a layer 3 switch. Layer 3 switch can perform routing as well. But all of those will be explained on your CCNA. Inter-VLAN is also included in your CCNA. Okay? Okay, now additional thing for you to study now is actually the password recovery for the router. Now most of the time you have some lazy engineers out there, like level 1, level 2 engineers. If they cannot access to the router, right, they will actually inform their boss, oh boss, the OS is corrupted. So you need to purchase new router. Okay? So normally, if they cannot access to the router, right, how come they cannot access? It's because the router, there's a password. For example, this is an old router. It has been there for many years, and your boss asks you, oh, we have a new site. I don't want to spend extra. I don't have budget. We don't want to spend extra money for that. We have an old router. So I want you to deploy it to a new site. Now, this is you try to access the router. And it prompts you something. Well, actually, this is the environment where you configure a router or a switch. So you're going to get used to it. Once you enroll in the CCNA, you're going to be dealing with all the commands. Okay? So I'll give you the first look for the command. I'll zoom in. I'll be giving you the software as well, the party software. Actually, it's free. It's an EXE software. You know, you can save it in your thumb drive. Once you go for CCNA, I'll give you all the copies for this one. Okay? Now, once you log in, it prompts you with a password. If the router is actually configured previously, okay, it will be a password. So you won't have any idea what is the password for this router, right? Maybe the previous engineer already resigned. Your boss is a new boss. This is not the previous boss. Nobody knows the password. So sometimes the engineer is really lazy. They'll actually say, oh, I cannot enter the router. I think the OS is corrupted, or what? The corrupted operating system. Actually, if there's corrupted operating system, if you happen to see this one, is a CF card. Actually, it's replaceable. It can be upgraded also. Okay, you press this one, you can change it if it's really corrupted. And then you will only see, you won't see the password there if it's corrupted. You'll see a funny characters. You know, like a sign or what. So you won't see the password wrong there. So this means it's corrupted. You can actually change the CF card. Can be changed once. But normally during operation, there's actually a warning here. You don't remove it during network operations, which means if you're currently about normal office hours, you try to explore your router, you press this one. This one is actually your this is where the operating system is stored. It's like your hard disk on your PC. Hard disk, okay? Imagine your PC is turned on and then you remove the hard disk. What will happen? Your PC will shut down, right? You crash, okay? Same thing with this one. So this is your hard disk. If you remove this, of course, no internet for your company, no connection, okay? So normally, there's only a password, it prompts you with a password, and nobody knows the password. You still can recover your router. How to recover? Well, you can actually perform the password recovery. Well, the easiest way is for you to connect to the party. I'll teach you once you go for CCNA. You must be connected. The connection for this one, actually when you purchase a router or switch or any Cisco device, it comes along with a free console cable. It's a blue color cable. The end will be this one. And this one, where is it coming from? Actually, you have to purchase it separately, but in my class, I am lending you this one for you to configure the router and the switch. Okay, so you have to plug in the serial to USB, the other end is USB, and plug into your PC. And then open up the app, which is, it could be a party or whatever app that you're using on your Windows OS, and then you can actually log in to the router. Okay, now you want to reset to the factory default setting. Anyone of you have used a wireless router before? You know the Linksys Cisco wireless router. Have you configured wireless router before? Yes, right? Normally we forget the password, correct? What do you do? What do you do when you forget the password? There's a reset button, right? The old wireless router is you have to poke, using a pin or a pen, you have to poke the reset button there. This one, there's nothing to poke, okay? The only way for you to reset it is via the console, okay? You have to shut it down, and then turn it on again. And then, of course, while it's turning on, you press the control brake, or brake, okay? Now, once you see the Roman mode, you have to stop. It's something like this. When you turn on or you boot up your Windows OS, right? When you boot up that one, if the BIOS. You have to press F2 or F9 or F6, right? Now, if you miss out that one, you will go to Windows logo. Windows logo, right? Now, this one, if you miss out, it will go to the password prompt. So this means you have to restart again. So once it's booting up, you have to press the control brake until you see this Roman mode and then you stop. Okay? Now what can you do here? Well, this mode is like a BIOS on your router. You want to reset to the factory default setting, right? Well, the next step is for you to place into the password recovery mode. What do you mean by password recovery mode? This means it will bypass any password that is configured in this router. Really easy. The command is actually confreg0x2142. Now you might be thinking, well, this is really difficult. If I go for CCNA, this means I need to memorize the command. No, you will get used to it. I'll tell you. I have students who are like accountants, chemical engineers, okay, business management students. And they were able to memorize every single command that I teach them. No worries, I always print out the commands in one page of paper. You just carry the paper along with you. You don't have to carry the book, you know, the very big book with you. Just carry the paper and it's okay. You're good to go. Okay? After enter this one, the next step, it says you must reset or power cycle for the config to take effect. Well, just follow, just type in reset, that's it. Enter. Now, once you enter, everything has been reset to the factory default setting. This means whatever configuration inside the router will be lost. Lost, okay? All the passwords, all the name will be lost, okay? Once you enter, you have to wait for it to load. Now, by the way, for the Cisco commands, you'll just have to press enter to execute the command, okay? When it's loading, it takes time. Okay, so we'll have to wait for the router to load. So once it loads, normally the network engineer is really happy because there's no password anymore. You know what they do? They try to configure everything, you know, whatever they need to do. Like the boss asks them to place this IP, place password, okay? And then they will leave it there. Actually, that's really dangerous. You don't leave it like that because password recovery mode, even though you save the config, if there's any power outage, right, it's still on the password recovery mode. You need to revert it back to the normal mode, which is 2100. Later on, I'll explain to you. Most of the network equipments, if this is a new configured equipment, nothing inside, it will normally ask you, would you like to enter initial configuration? This is like a wizard, you know, wizard is like a step-by-step guide. Normally, if you place no, why? If you place yes, it will ask you something like you have to input the password. But if you make a mistake, you input the wrong spelling password, you cannot go back. So it's better for you to manually configure the router. So you normally place no on the wizard and you do it yourself. So if you make a mistake, you still can overwrite the mistake, okay? So it will load now, and then you're inside the router. No more inside, no more passwords. So you just type it enable, then you can configure everything. Back to the normal mode. Now, there are chances that some engineers, they want to recall the previous config. They're really curious. Oh, I want to find out what's the previous configuration for this router. Well, there is a way for you to recall that because it's actually saved on the NVRAM of your router. There is a command. The command is called copy. Well, Cisco command accepts shortcut. Okay, copy start run. The long command for this one is copy startup config. Running config. That's very long, right? Well, the good news is for Cisco, it's actually accepting shortcuts. Okay, copy start run. Now I press enter, and I can see now, previously, this router is configured as strawberry. And if I check the config, just show run, by the way, I'll explain this to you once you enroll in CCNA. Enter. And then the password I can see is actually Cisco. So whatever the network engineer configured last time, you were able to recover it. What's the advantage? There's no more password. No password, but you can recover the config. Now, can you do that in your current company? Of course you can do that, but someone can, they might catch you, okay? They might catch you doing this one. Because if you want to find out what's the config in your company, you want to bypass the password, it's possible. The only problem is if the company has monitoring tool, then they can see that you log into the device, okay? And that's it. Now, of course, I can place in whatever password that I want to place in. And in order for me to revert, I need to revert back to the normal mode, which is this one. You will learn everything in CCNA. You need to revert back to the normal mode, which is config register 0x2102. This is the normal mode. So you press enter, everything is going to be on normal mode. To save it, actually, there's a shortcut for you to save. Config is WRI, or in your exam is copy run start to save. That's it. Enter. That's it. You already recovered the router. Does it prompt me with a password? No, not anymore. I was able to enter it. Okay. Now in CCNA, now you cannot understand every single thing, but in your CCNA, you'll definitely understand this one. And this is only a demo on how the environment will look like and how will you recover the password for your network equipment, okay? Let's go back to the... Okay. Well, there is a transition for Cisco curriculum nowadays. Now, some students are actually in a hurry to go for the version 2. Why? Because they're scared of version 3. Of course, if there's something new, it's really difficult to pass, right? You got it? Yeah? It's something new. Definitely, nobody has taken this before. I'm going to be the first batch, or you're going to be the first batch. Is it really tough? Well, transition-wise, we don't know yet the coverage, the format for the exam, okay? But no worries, once we teach the CCNA version 3, definitely for the changes, it's not too much, okay? Last time, we also migrated for the previous code, which is last time is 802. 640.802, then migrated to 200.120, which is the current version now, okay? Now, during the transition, we have students who are taking the exam. And so far, they were able to pass. Okay, now when Cisco migrate to a new curriculum, there's not a lot of difference, okay? Normally, they won't shift tremendously to a lot of topics. They won't change a lot of topics, okay? They will try to change, maybe add in six questions to 10 questions, change a bit on the simulation on the lab, okay? But normally, whatever you have studied on the previous version will still remain intact in the exam. Now, it's up to you, whichever you prefer. You want to go for the old version, it's still valid. If you are certified maybe this July, you just count 3 years, your cert is still valid. If you are certified with a new version, which is version 3, count 3 years. Let's just say you pass in August, okay? Count 3 years. After 3 years, your cert is still valid. Okay? So whichever version you take, it's still valid. So which one do you prefer? Would you prefer the latest one or the older one? Well, I tell you, the older one is easier to pass. Why? Because we know, we have proof that student already passed. Our previous students already passed. We know the content. We know how to expect, what to expect on your exam. For the version 3, right now, we don't know because nobody has taken it yet. Okay? But advantage for taking the version 3 will be the following topics. You'll get to learn more about IPv6 routing. Although, in version 2, I'm actually teaching the IPv6 routing. Now you will study all the routing protocols, application of IPv6 on your router. You'll be configuring IPv6, you'll be doing some ping tests, which actually we're doing in version 2 as well. Is I try to make sure that the student will get the same, you know, same information, you know, once the Cisco upgrade, they still have the same topics, okay? And for IPv4, last time, there's one routing protocol called OSPF. The additional one is actually the multi-area. OSPF normally has some factors like AS number and the area number, which is in CCNA version 2, you need to have the same area, the same AS, but in version 3, different area, different AS will do. Okay, that's the additional one. Well, normally I teach this one in CCNP, but now they actually include it in CCNA. Now, switches redundancy. I normally give a preview in version 2 on how to create redundancy or how to perform redundancy in your switches, but that doesn't involve configuration. But in version 3, it involves the config, okay? The configuration. So that's redundancy. Normally, we use 2 to 8 links combined together to perform redundancy. We call it ether channel. Okay. I'm not sure you have heard it before. Now for switches, switches is capable of eliminating loops in your network, especially the Cisco switches. They eliminate looping in your network. They call it spanning tree. Okay. Now actually, I explained really briefly and really detailed in CCNA about spanning tree, and definitely you won't forget it, and you will apply it in your company. So the additional thing here is the rapid BVSD. I normally teach BVSD in version 2. The additional is rapid BVSD, which is only one command. Well, no worries for that. It's only one command. Okay? If the command is BVSD, you'll just place rapid-BVSD. That's it. That's rapid BVSD. Okay? Now, GRE tunnel, which is really not existing in your version 2, really don't have. It's actually included in CCNP, but now they have added it in the CCNA. Now all of this is actually not included yet on the simulation or the lab exam. It's only included on multiple choice in version 3. Okay, so you don't have to worry. Okay, and there is an introduction for layer 3 switches in version 3. In version 2 CCNA, there's no introduction, although I'll give an intro to layer 3 switches, but here there will be more intro, which is redundancy for your layer 3, how to configure intervenant and layer 3. A preview for that is also included in the new version. So that's a lot of things, right? It's like taking half of CCNP class, okay? Now, this advantage for version 3 is, as I told you, nobody has taken the exam yet. Okay? That's a disadvantage, but I told you, the exam could be slightly similar to the version 2. It won't have a lot of changes. So it's up to you. You want to go for version 2 or version 3? It's up to you. They're both valid. They're both you can be certified for either of the following. Okay? We will start offering the version 3 this August. For version 2, we are already offering it. There's a lot of students who are enrolling for version 2, because they actually want to pass the exam. You know, if your target is to pass the exam immediately, then you go for version 2. If your target is to just to have knowledge, then maybe you can go for version 3. Okay? Okay, exam, what to expect? Well, exam will be shorter for version 3. Shorter. Version 2 is around 140 minutes, but version 3 is actually 90 minutes. So, not yet. So, we don't know yet, but definitely they might eliminate some stuff in version 3, which is existing in version 2. Okay? So, lesser and addressing question, that's the reason why. And more labs, there could be chances that they will have more labs and lesser multiple choice. And more on IPv6 multiple choice. Okay? Because the version 2 will have a lot of multiple.
multiple choice, and there will be some labs, okay? But version 3 definitely, they might eliminate some of the multiple choice. That's the reason why it's shorter. Questions? Okay, it's your decision. You want to pass immediately, you take version 2. You're okay with taking version 3 and you want to be a pioneer, you take version 3. No worries. All students here, passing rate currently is around 95% in about. We did run the first ever version 2 here in Singapore, actually, which was like 3 years ago. So far, the first batch of those students who took the exam all passed. They all passed, the first batch. So we're actually really not so confident that they will all pass, but so far they passed. So this means that, you know, not a lot of changes when it comes to exam. But of course, if you don't want to risk, you take version 3. If you're okay with the risk, then you take version 3. Career path, as I told you earlier, for the career path for Cisco certified students or Cisco certified engineers, normally they can take the level 1 or level 2, you know, level 1 engineer support, okay, network engineer level 1. Once they become CCNP, they can take over level 2 and level 3 support. Okay, what's a little bit of features for our training center. Normally, for our training center, we provide one-to-one equipment. So this means you're going to be having your own router, your own switch, you're going to be doing your own lab. Only the first day is actually the concepts. So you'll be studying how to troubleshoot OSI, TCP, IP, what are the common problems in your company and how to resolve it. The second day onwards, you're going to be doing the lab. So you're not going to be doing it alone, of course. Like what I did earlier, you're going to be doing it together with me. So this means I'll give you the instruction, you'll have to do it together. After that, that's the time you'll have to perform, you know, some topologies. Normally, I don't follow whatever is written on the book, because the book, the topics are all over the place. They start with IP, after that, routing, after that, switching. You see, it's really confusing. Now, normally in my class, we start with concepts, addressing. How can you configure or program a device if you don't know about addressing, right? You need to know addressing. You need to know how to play subnet mask. You need to know what is /24/16/30. What are those? Okay? So you need to know everything before you start the hands-on. So after that, we'll have to start with the local area network, which is the LAN. Switches, which is easier for you to configure, right? Switches is easier to configure compared to the routers. After the LAN, we'll have to go through the WAN. So you're going to be configuring the third day, you're going to be configuring router and then a switch, and you'll have your PC connected to the switch. After that, performing routing, IPv4, then IPv6, then going back to the campus network, which is inter-VLAN, and after that, additional features on your router, which is security, access control list, NAT, DHCP, all of those. So the very difficult topics are not in front, they are not in the middle of the class. It's going to be at the last part. The first part are all the easy topics. Unlike in your book, it's all mixed up. Easy, tough, easy, tough, easy. So it's all together. So in my class, we start from the basic until every day it will be tougher and tougher. Okay? Question. Do you have any questions? Are you confident enough for version 3 or version 2? Well, if you plan to take your cert at the end of the year, I'll tell you, version 3, I wouldn't know the price or the cost for the exam. Normally, when they change, they make a lot of changes. If they make a change, the price could be higher for the exam. Okay? Last time when I took my CCNA, you know how much is the price? 2006, I took my CCA, right? The price is around $200 only. That was 2006. I think less than $200. Now, you know how much is the price? 540 plus. Right, around 500 plus. You see the difference? You want to postpone your certification from now until you know how many years. So maybe your salary can increase. I have students who have taken CCNA. After they finish the CCNA and get certified, they got promotion. And others, they change job, they change company. Definitely the salary will be higher. So it's up to you. Certification is really an investment. It's either your company sponsored or not company sponsored, it doesn't matter. You have to sponsor yourself for, you need to invest yourself, for your future, okay? For me, I did sponsor myself. I was studying at the same time, working. So I took the certification before I go ahead in the industry. So my first job is actually teaching, second is network engineer. I didn't go for desktop support, IT support. But of course, I did perform, I did attend some classes, training for desktop and server. So you'll be really, really good in troubleshooting. In the industry, they will hire people who can troubleshoot. Okay, they won't hire people who just know this and that. Okay? They will ask you, if you cannot answer, definitely you'll fail your interview. They will ask you, what is the command for you to check whether routing is present? What is the show command? Okay? So if you are going for a high level, they will ask you those questions. What is the redundancy command for router and switches? So they will ask you troubleshooting issues. If there's no internet in your company, what's the first step that you will have to do? Right? If someone complained he cannot remote into the server, what's the first step that you'll have to do? Or if someone complained this user or this network cannot access to that network, what is the problem? So if you cannot answer, definitely you won't get a job. Okay, so make sure that you're really good at troubleshooting, not only configuration. Any questions? Questions? Okay. By the way, we did.